Good morning. Welcome to Grand River Unitarian Congregation. Whether you are joining us here in person or online this morning or at a time of your choosing, I'm honored that you've chosen to spend this morning with us together. My name is Rev Jess, and it has been my pleasure to serve this congregation for the past 16 years. And it's... thank you. I'm glad that still gets applause. Very different kind of service. Awkward. It is a special joy this morning to actually be serving as a service leader to introduce and frame a reflection by a member of our worship arts team, Brenda Moen. Yeah. Also applause or awkward. At our last brainstorming meeting, Brenda and I shared our disbelief at having each reached the ripe old age of 60 in the past year. And today, she'll share what she's been learning about the aspiration we both share, how to age gracefully. In that regard, I've found congregational life with its multi-generational membership to be a vital component in this regard. So many of you have served as role models, as inspiration, as sage advisors. And for this, I am deeply grateful, and I know that my life is better for it. My hope for each of you is that you too find in this community a warm welcome, inspiring companionship, and engaging conversations. To that end, today, right after the postlude, you are invited to stay and join me up here for the return of a popular game known as Conversation Starters. This is a 20-minute game. It's a kind of speed date interview where we line up to respond to a series of questions for sharing on topics from the simple to the sublime. There's no coffee today, so you might as well stay up here to talk. That's today after the service. There's also two other things after service today. You are invited to sign a petition calling on the Ontario government to do more to protect and create affordable housing. See Colin. Will you stand up, Colin, and wave at people so they can find you? Find Colin downstairs after the service. He'll be circulating with the petition. If you are of a mind, please sign. And also, there was a dream auction event this weekend called the Bodacious Bobble Swap. And apparently there were more donations than they could absorb in the gathering. And so Melissa Rockenfield, Mel Rock, right here, she is offering that you please take what you like and give what you can because the dream auction keeps on giving. And you'll see she's very blinged out with some of the bodacious baubles that are on offer today. Thank you so much for continuing to share that goodness with us, Melissa. And Friday night, speaking of giving and giving and giving, many of us were here for a fundraising party to benefit a better tent city. And here with an update and an invitation is our very own board president, Wendy Martin.
Good morning, GRU. If you don't know, for the past year or so, our congregation has been building a relationship with a better tent city to help with housing and feeding our neighbors. So on Friday, we had a fabulous event, a fundraiser, featuring Creaky Knees and our own Tom Collins. A Better Tent City came to us and told us that they were in dire need of a new range to put in their kitchen so they could continue to feed people. And the bare minimum amount that they needed to collect was $3,000. on Friday night, we collected $2,571.40. Thank you, everyone, to all our volunteers, our participants, our donors, even little Sebastian, who came to dance with us. So we want to do more than the bare minimum. We want to make sure they get the range, they can pay to install it, they might even get some pots and pans and some food to go in it. So let's keep it going. Today we are doing a special collection, and we are trying out a new process for this. So in the pews, you will see two envelopes, your regular white envelope, and if you put money in this envelope and put it in the collection plate, it will go to GRU as usual. And there are colored envelopes. We don't distinguish colored people, but we do distinguish colored envelopes. And it does not matter what color, as long as it is not white. So anything that goes in one of these envelopes will go to a better tent city. And then they all go in the same collection plate, and I'll be able to tell which is which. Nice and easy, right? A couple other details. If you filled out on Friday a form saying you were going to e-transfer your payment, please don't forget to do that and put ABTC in the memo line. And if you filled out an IOU and you are paying for it in one of these envelopes, please put your name and IOU in the corner, and then I can match your IOU to your payment. You will notice on both envelopes there is a place for your name and address. This does not get you special privileges, but it will get you a tax receipt. So if you need one of those, please put your name and address on the envelope. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Wendy,
yes?
There are not enough colored envelopes.
Okay, if anyone has an extra one that they are not using, would you please raise it up so that someone who needs it can grab it? If
neighbor. It's like, turn and share your envelopes, please.
Okay, there are also extra pins in the back if you need a pin to fill out your envelope. Thank you, everyone.
Dress rehearsal, but trust me, this is a far easier process than the last time we tried to figure this out. Thank you, Wendy, and thank you, Kristen, for helping us figure that out. That will be taken up in one plate at the offertory later in the service. I want to thank everyone who donated, participated, danced, baked, and ate. Thank you for supporting this crazy little idea that started with my purchasing a performance by Creaky Knees at the Dream Auction back in November. And I said, well, the venue of my choice would be the congregation. And then I thought, what if we made it a fundraiser? So thank you again, everyone who said yes. Thank you to our party team, Doug, Brenda, Anna, Colin, Greg, Irena, and Teresa. Thanks to Nicole, who served as our Better Tent City liaison, and to people who stayed and helped that night, Kathy Scott, Jessica Bain, Lisa, and Mike, and Wendy, and our musicians, Tracy, Lee, Tom, and Colin. It was a fabulous night. And now, all of the business and the busyness, let's just set that aside for a moment and settle our hearts and our hands and our heads as we turn from our daily lives and consent for this hour to simply be together. Jules Jaramillo writes, "This morning we gathered together to worship as a community of all ages. Let us take a moment to look around at those of us sharing this sacred space. Let us recognize the hearts of our whole community, from our elders to our youngest and all the ages in between. Let us embody the beauty of this whole church community, even when there are a few more wiggles, giggles, and chatter. That's the soundtrack of our future. Let us remind ourselves to listen carefully, calming our bodies and our minds. Let us begin by breathing peace and joy into this sacred space with three breaths. Breathing in, breathing out. Breathing in, breathing out. Breathing in, breathing out. Will you please rise in body or in spirit for our opening hymn, number 354, We Laugh, We Cry. It's in the gray hymnals, 354.
Thank you.
In his book, Aging as a Spiritual Practice, Lewis Richmond writes, "Everything changes, yes, but that truth has two sides. It is true that everything we love is destined to change, age, and pass away. But it is equally true that every moment brings with it new possibilities. We shouldn't allow our fixed ideas about aging to take those opportunities away. One of my Buddhist teachers liked to say, every breath, new chances. So if we say that everything changes, we should also add that everything is workable, maybe especially our old age. Once, one of my workshop attendees raised his hand and half-jokingly said, I'm 58, and I know where I'm headed, downhill. It's all downhill from here. I thought for a moment, and I replied, well, I'm not sure I agree, but even if you're right, the real question is, are you going to just slide or are you going to steer?
I could always strut in style, please the girls with my big smile. Then it was just a once in a while. Mojo, where'd you go? Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Where'd you go? Respect back in the day, people listened to what I'd say. Then it started slipping away. Mojo, where'd you go? Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Where'd you go? Hey, Mojo. Where'd you go? Wish I might, wish I may, keep the mojo here to stay. But there is no magic way to hold back the waves of time. Looks to me like it's going away. Looks to me like it ain't gonna stay. Now I have to find a way. Mojo, where'd you go? Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Hey, Mojo. Where'd you go, Mojo?
Where did you go, Mojo? Our service this morning is an effort, as Lewis Richmond says, to help you steer, to put a few stars in the sky to help us all navigate. Aging is beyond our control, but how we age is largely up to us. So come, let us reclaim our mojo together. Let this flame be to us a symbol of the wholeness we seek. Its glow reminding us of the sacred bonds which link us to all people. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve humanity in harmony with the earth, Thus do we covenant together. Children of all ages are invited forward for a special story with Becky.
Good morning, everybody. I have a special story this morning called Miss Rumphius, and this was one of my favorite stories when I was a kid, because I also have an aunt who lives by the sea and works in a library, and you'll see the girl in this book has one of those too. And this book is a little bit long, so I'm going to skip a few pages. The Lupine Lady lives in a small house overlooking the sea. In between the rocks around her house grow blue and purple and rose-colored flowers. The Lupine Lady is little and old, but she has not always been that way, I know. She is my great aunt, and she told me so. Once upon a time, she was a little girl named Alice, who lived in a city by the sea. Many years ago, her grandfather had come to America on a large sailing ship. In the evening, Alice sat on her grandfather's knee and listened to his stories of faraway places. When he had finished, Alice would say, "When I grow up, I too will go to faraway places. And when I grow old, I too will live beside the sea." "That is all very well, little Alice," said her grandfather, "but there is a third thing you must do." "What is that?" asked Alice. "You must do something to make the world more beautiful," said her grandfather. "All right," said Alice, but she did not know what that could be. In the meantime, Alice got up and washed her face and ate porridge for breakfast. She went to school and came home and did her homework, and pretty soon she was grown up. Then my great aunt Alice set out to do the three things she told her grandfather she was going to do. She left home and went to live in a city far away from the sea and the salt air. There she worked in a library, dusting books and keeping them from getting mixed up and helping people find the ones they wanted. Some of the books told her about faraway places. People called her Miss Rumphius now. Sometimes she went to the conservatory in the middle of the park. When she stepped inside on a wintry day, the warm, moist air wrapped itself around her, and the sweet smell of jasmine filled her nose. "This is almost like a tropical isle," said Miss Rumphius, "but not quite." So Miss Rumphius went to a real tropical island, where people kept cockatoos and monkeys as pets. She walked on long beaches, picking up beautiful shells. My great aunt Rumphius climbed tall mountains where the snow never melted. She went through jungles and across deserts. She saw lions playing and kangaroos jumping. And everywhere she made friends she would never forget. Finally, she came to the land of lotus eaters, and there, getting off a camel, she hurt her back. "What a foolish thing to do," said Miss Rumphius. "Well, I have certainly seen faraway places. That was number one thing. Maybe it is time to find my place by the sea." And it was, and she did. From the porch of her new house, Miss Rumphius watched the sun come up. She watched it cross the heavens and sparkle on the water, and she saw it set in glory in the evening. She started a little garden, and she planted a few flower seeds in the stony ground. Miss Rumphius was almost perfectly happy. "But there is still one more thing I have to do," she said. "I have to do something to make the world more beautiful." "But what? The world is already pretty nice," she thought, looking out over the ocean. The next spring, Miss Rumphius was not very well. Her back was bothering her again, and she had to stay in bed most of the time. The flowers she had planted the summer before had come up and bloomed in spite of the stony ground. See them peeking through the window there? She could see them from her bedroom window, blue and purple and rose-colored. "Lupines," said Miss Rumphius with satisfaction. "I have always loved lupines the best." After a hard winter, spring came. Miss Rumphius was feeling much better. Now she could take long walks again. One day she was out walking. "I can't believe my eyes," she said. There, on the other side of the hill, was a large patch of blue and purple and rose-colored lupines. "It must have been the wind that brought the seeds from my garden here, and the birds must have helped." Then Miss Rumphius had a wonderful idea. She hurried home and got out her seed catalogs. She set off for the very best seeds for 5 bushels of lupine seed. All that summer, Miss Rumphius, her pockets full of seeds, wandered over fields and headlands, sowing lupines. She scattered seeds across the highways and down the country lanes. She flung handfuls of them around the schoolhouse and the back of the church. She tossed them into hollows and along stone walls. Her back didn't hurt her anymore. Now some people called her that crazy old lady. The next spring, there were lupines everywhere. Fields and hillsides were covered with blue and purple and rose-colored flowers. They bloomed along the highways and down the lanes. Bright patches lay around the schoolhouse and back of the church. Down in the hollows and along the stone walls grew the beautiful flowers. Miss Rumpheus had done the third, the most difficult thing at all. My great aunt Alice, Miss Rumpheus, is very old now. Her hair is white. Every year, there are more and more lupines. Now they call her the Lupine Lady. Sometimes me and my friends go visit her. My friends think she is the oldest woman in the world. Often she tells us stories of faraway places. When I grow up, I tell her, I too will go to faraway places and come home to live by the sea. That is all very well, little Alice, says my aunt, but there is a third thing you must do. What is that, I ask? You must do something to make the world more beautiful. All right, I say. But I do not know yet what that could be. The end.
I love when there are enough kids here and we get to the second verse and we're all singing a different verse, and it just seems the most Unitarian thing ever. We have a responsive reading this morning. If you would turn in the gray hymnals to reading number 468. 468. This is a piece by George O'Dell. And I'll ask those who wish to do so to respond with the italics. We need one another when we mourn and would be comforted.
We need,
we need one another when we are in despair, in temptation, and need to be recalled to our best selves again. We need one another in the hour of success, when we look for someone to share our triumphs. We need one another when we come to die and would have gentle hands prepare us for the journey.
Our weekly offering is not just for the support of the building itself, but the building of community within these walls and beyond its windows. How we spend our money is a reflection on what we hold to be important. When we sustain our church, we sustain our deepest values together. One of those values is hospitality. So today we extend our offering to a better tent city. And I'm sorry, but the fact that we did not have enough envelopes is just the greatest thing ever. Thank you for your generous support of this community and the wider community.
I wanna find me some gold before I get old, before my time flies away. Well, I'll shed some tears, wanna lose some fears before my time flies away. Looking for treasure under an ocean, it's deep and dark down here. How do I measure all I discover that brings a smile and a tear? Oh, well, I'll find me some gold before I get old, before my time flies away. Well, I realize I gotta open my eyes before my time flies away. Well, I have been flying over the mountains, the air gets thin up there. Can't hear my crying or feel my heart breaking, moment so high in the air. Gonna find me some gold before I get old, before my time flies away. Well, I'll make my choice and find a new voice before my time flies away. Now I'm sitting here going nowhere, no need to run the race. Looking around, making my sound, putting a smile on my face. Gonna find me some gold before I get old, before my time flies away. Well, I'll shed some tears, gonna lose some fears before my time flies away. 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 Before my time flies away.
Thank you so much, Jane. We take our time on our Sundays together to honor the joys and sorrows, the trials and triumphs of our everyday lives, held up for community, sorrow, or celebration. You're invited to light a candle in silence, or if there's something you'd like to share, you can come to the microphone, let us know your name, and how we might support you in your journey today. Alas, we light a first candle that we may work for peace in this world.
Hello, my name is Colin. The responsive reading, which talked about needing others to do things that are too big to do on our own, just resonates with me, and I'd like to echo what Jess already said. It was such fun on Friday to just see a whole group of people come together, each doing a small little bit to create a really fun evening, but more than that, to hit and surpass our goal for the Better Tent City. So that's what community is about. So thank you all.
Since we're talking about aging today, a very happy birthday to my big brother and to my son. Some of you know Nico. I'm not quite sure how this happened, but he's turning 24.
My name is Lisa. I'm a big sister with Big Brothers Big Sisters, and before COVID, probably 2019, the match that I had, we had to leave each other for circumstances in her life. She moved, and long story. And I got a surprise call from her yesterday. And so it was precious because I was struggling to try and keep in contact with her from her end. And it was quite the gift to hear from her. She's 14 now.
I'm lighting a candle today for a friend of mine who I found out last night was in a terrible household accident, and she is facing a third surgery now in as many weeks to treat third-degree burns. So, for my friend.
I happened to run into a friend who knows our former congregation member, Lee Dickey, and got sort of an update on Lee. And he is out west living near his daughter, Sonia. And apparently he's had a couple of falls and injured himself and is having difficulty with mobility and is quite gloomy. And I was just thinking it might be nice to send him some cards or something. I'm not sure with his memory issues how much he will remember the people here, but I certainly remember him.
If you can get us an address, then we will send that through. That's been the barrier. Thank you. Thank you so much. So for our beloved Lee.
Earlier this month, our son David defended his dissertation. He is now Dr. David Helps.
Just thinking of Jim Booth, he had some kidney stones over the weekend, and so thinking of him as he endures the pain until he can get those blasted out.
Our lives are necessarily a mix. William Blake said, joy and woe are woven fine. Let's light a final candle for all of those joys and sorrows here unspoken, but precious in the privacy of our hearts. Please join me in singing our pastoral response, Spirit of Life.
Thank you.
Our meditation words today are by Elizabeth Lane Darcy and Mary Grigolia. This is called Prayer for the Second Half of Life. Spirit of life, we hold in our hearts all who are in the second half of life, those who aspire to move from aging to saging. We breathe with those whose hearts have been broken open that we may continue to grow in love. We breathe with all who have been disappointed that we may continue to dream. We breathe with all who no longer find delight in the activities of our youth that we may find new delights. We breathe with those who live with daily pain that we may find comfort and strength to greet each day anew. We breathe with those experiencing new limits in the body, grieving the loss of what we once could do, held by the body's possibilities still with us. We breathe with those whose fire is running low. May we open to the spark of inspiration and new life. May our journeys of aging and awakening together be a blessing.
Everything, the good and the bad, will come and go over time. All the stories that I know will come and go in my mind. But I will remember you. Trading tales of glory days. Just drop the show. What about your dear sweet mom? Oh, I didn't know. Well, I'd like to ask if your lover is still around, but I don't know how. Yeah.
everything, the good and the bad, will come and go over time. All the stories that I know will come and go in my mind, but I will remember you. Looking back in time, nothing was what it seemed to be, but I still remember what you mean to me. Everything, the good and the bad, will come and go over time. All the stories that I
feel like I need to say good morning. Early in the fall, I shared with you that I had turned 60. This milestone birthday got me questioning a lot of things in my life, and I'm here to share what I've learned since then. Can you hear me okay? Volume's okay? Okay. As I started to seriously consider how I should go forward into my senior years, my golden years, my second half, or my old age, and I don't really like any of those terms, I found that I felt like I did in my late teenage years. Unfortunately, not full of youthful energy, but I found myself wrestling with big nebulous questions like, what am I supposed to be doing with the rest of my life? What makes a happy, healthy, and long old age? And what makes a sad, sick, and short old age? And where can I get help with this stage of life? Like many of you, I'm sure, when I was much younger, I aspired to live a long life. I remember hoping to reach 100. But now I want to prioritize quality over quantity. I want a happy, healthy third act. That's my current favorite term, third act. And I want to age, maybe not gracefully, but well. We'll try. So please follow along with me, because although many of you are well into your third act and doing amazing, this advice can be helpful even for kids who are 40 or younger. After all, we're all getting older every day. And I wish I knew the things that I learned 20 or 30 years ago. And at the end, I will tell you how GRU can play a really important role in helping us all age well. Having begun my third act, I started to do what many of you would. I began to research aging and went down a rabbit hole with lots of twists and turns. I found that a lot of information existed on the topic of aging well, but the three authors I ended up focusing were and I've accidentally set them up in reverse order. So Arthur C. Brooks, who wrote From Strength to Strength, a book based on his personal research and experience about the changes that come with middle age, and his suggestions about how to have a successful second half. That's his term. He has written many columns and shorter articles on the topic as well. Robert Waldinger and Mark Schultz, in their book The Good Life, do a very detailed examination of what longitudinal research shows makes for a good life and their suggestions for how to have one. And Michael Greger, in the book called How Not to Age, focuses in great detail, and I do mean great detail, on the importance of certain foods in preventing disease and infirmary. And by the way, thank you to the GRU members out there who suggested books and articles for me. They were very helpful. And as I hear on, I think it's TikTok, I read the information so you didn't have to. There is a lot of information in these three books, and so I'm going to pare it down to a reasonable amount of information for you to take in today. There is certainly enough information in any one of these books to run a six-week book study in the future. Not that I'm volunteering just now. Brooks shares an analogy that I think is very helpful for thinking about setting yourself up for a good third act. He says, preparing for old age as a younger person is like saving money in an RSP for your retirement. The more you invest and the earlier you get started, the richer your retirement will be. You shouldn't wait until you're 65 to start saving for retirement. And you shouldn't wait until you're a senior before you start thinking about how to have a good old age. Well, at least I've started now. So how does one age well? What am I supposed to be doing with the rest of my life? Well, generally speaking, we need to actively take care of our body, mind, and spirit, our whole selves, our whole lives, and every day. That seems very sensible. And I'm pleased to report that none of the authors suggest that we need to run a 10K daily, eat a high-kale diet, and meditate three times a day. If that was the case, I wouldn't be up here. Brooks wrote a quite accessible article called The Seven Habits That Lead to Happiness in Old Age. It echoes much of what all of the other experts say. And his advice for building up your happiness in old age bank account is don't smoke, don't drink too much, maintain a healthy weight by eating lots of fruits and vegetables, prioritize movement in scheduling and exercise every day, develop healthy coping mechanisms to deal with life's stresses. This could be learning spiritual practice, journaling, going to therapy, anything that will, to develop healthy emotional reactions to the inevitable stress that comes with living a long life. Keep learning and growing. An active mind in old age means a happier mind and a longer, happier life. You don't have to take university courses, just read or play board games that keep your mind engaged and challenged. This makes new connections in the brain and seems to slow cognitive decline as well. And finally, making the time and effort to develop and cultivate warm, stable, long-term relationships in your life. Find people that you can grow with and count on, and be someone that others can count on too. I'm going to come back to relationships again. In addition, offered as a general rule in several sources, is the advice that one of the most important things to do for your health at any age is to check your blood pressure and your cholesterol and get it under control if it's problematic, as heart attack and stroke are still the two leading causes of premature death in the 50-plus age group. The detailed advice that is found in Greger's book, How Not to Age, is boiled down to eat a diet of 90% plant-based food, especially leafy greens, berries, whole grains, nuts and seeds, legumes, herbs, get daily exercise, take vitamin B12 and D3, and drink green tea. And even if you don't follow these perfectly, he's very reassuring with this. Any change is better than no change. So try your best. Personally, what I've taken away from this is to fill my plate with 50% vegetables. I'm slowly working up to 90. Many of the authors I've read had one thing in common. They were middle-aged. And when they had an epiphany that something in their lives had changed and they weren't as happy as they used to be, they did what I did. They started to research. And then they discovered that it wasn't just them who was having this feeling. So they did their research and they felt compelled to share it with us as I am sharing it with you. Both Brooks and Waldinger and Schultz used data from a longitudinal study I hadn't heard of, but now want to learn a lot more about, called the Harvard Study of Adult Development, as a source for their data for their arguments about having a good life and old age. This is a study that began in 1938 with a group of 268 sophomore Harvard students. It followed them through life and regularly surveyed them, interviewed them, and accessed their medical records. As the years went on, this study subsumed another study that was following a group of 14-year-old boys who had lived in disadvantaged neighborhoods in Boston. And later yet, the study took in the spouses and children of the original Harvard subjects. While this is not the most diverse or inclusive study, it is instructive. And the data is a treasure trove of the trials, tribulations, successes, and failures of a group of remarkably candid people over a very long stretch of years. The most relevant data for our purposes is what the authors found when they sifted through the interviews and surveys to find those who considered themselves happy in their final years, in their later years. The happiest of them were those who had made time to cultivate good, warm relationships and who found meaning in being part of a community. That cliche that no one on their deathbed says, "I wish I'd spent more time at the office," turns out to be true. The most common regret that 80-year-olds reported was not spending enough time with loved ones. They reported that what mattered most, what they were proudest of as they neared the end of their lives, was their relationships with family, friends, and the community they lived in. But the key, they admitted, was to make time and put in the effort to keep these relationships going. One of the things that they identified as preventing them from doing this was being too busy, specifically too busy working. Many of us spend a large amount of our time and energy at work. This especially is true as if we are what Brooks calls a striver. Someone who strives for excellence, is focused on achieving success, and is hard driving. Some might call that being a workaholic. And this is something I can see as a theme in my career, I will confess. Something I'm still trying to fix in retirement. A striver is someone who keeps madly chasing work goals, even though if they stop for a moment, they might find that working too hard is not making them happy, or at least not giving them lasting happiness. If all we do is work, we will have nothing but work in the end, and work will eventually come to an end for most of us. Brooks talks about how a lack of happiness with being a workaholic results from the way that the human brain, the prefrontal cortex in particular, that's the part with the working memory and the executive function, how it's wired and how it ages. In our teens and 20s and even into our 30s, we are full of what he calls fluid intelligence, the innovative problem-solving raw smarts that make young people such quick learners and so creative. It is natural to work hard at this point in life to establish a career, start a family, get the house, whatever. And at this stage, some people become addicted to the accolades or rewards or short-term wins at work, and work becomes the most important thing in their lives. By the time we hit our 40s, there is a natural decline in that fluid intelligence and the emergence of crystallized intelligence, Brooks says, which is the wisdom from our experience and knowledge and the ability to make connections between ideas and with other people. Think about Albert Einstein, who made his three major discoveries in his 20s and spent the rest of his career extending these ideas. We shouldn't deny our decline and risk falling into the trap of working harder and harder while getting less and less in return, and thereby risking mental and physical illness. The good news is that as we see our decline, that working on relationships and major years, their message is clear. Giving and receiving love or connection with others is what makes life meaningful. Waldinger and Schultz say, we need to do the right things to have a happy and healthy versus a sad and sick old age. And according to the Harvard study subjects, it is easy to fall into depression, anxiety, or poor health as we age. Many parts of our lives inevitably change over a long life. Sadly, we lose parents, siblings, partners, neighbors, and friends. But change doesn't have to be negative. While there are some things we can't change, there are many we can. We can work to get healthier and do things to make us happier. One of these is to find a way to contribute to the world, to find meaning in our later years. And we can take pride in having strong relationships with others who count on us as much as we count on them. We can find new communities, new interests, and activities, and make new connections with new people. We often hear that isolation is an epidemic today, as might be argued are anxiety, depression, and even dementia. Brooks says these are all tied together. We are built to be social animals, happiest in small groups. When we are not in a group, we get stressed. While we don't have to worry about being attacked by lions or bears anymore, being alone, the stress of being isolated is real and dangerous. Chronic stress is, quite frankly, deadly. Good relationships give us emotional support, mental stimulation, a sense of belonging, and make us feel better. While research shows that face-to-face interaction is best, even a text or a Zoom call is better than nothing. All of the time we spend talking to others is a small connection to the world, and being socially isolated has been shown to increase the risk of mental and physical illness at any age. Now, this is important. I want to be clear about this, because many of us feel this sense of social isolation in our lives, even if we don't share it with others. There is no shame in admitting to feeling lonely and seeking out connections with others. Studies have shown that 1/3 of people over 45 feel lonely. I think we need to start today, right now, let's try it, to normalize saying, I would like to make a new friend, or I am looking for a social connection. Think about how much less the average person today spends interacting with family and friends than our grandparents did, and how that adversely affects us as human beings. Finding a faith community, or for some of us at group, a spiritual community, and for others of us at group, just a community, is often recommended as a solution for isolation in older adults, especially those who have left the workforce. A place like GRU has a lot to offer at any age. Besides connecting with others, cultivating spirituality can strengthen well-being and health as well. Mindfulness and meditation support mental health and can help you better navigate life stresses more easily. Reading spiritual books, listening to uplifting music, spending time in nature, serving others, and practicing gratitude all make life better. As part of a larger community, you can find ways to discover deeper meaning in life by becoming part of something bigger than yourselves. In fact, searching for a community to be part of and wanting to find meaning in something bigger than ourselves is what drew Doug and I to GRU in the first place, and we count our blessings that we found you. Even after all that research about aging, and I just have to say, these are thick books. It's a lot of reading. So you know I had big questions if I kept going. So So I did a bit more research to find out more specifically how attending GRU can help us all at any age. Broadly, it offers those personal connections, relationships, and a feeling of belonging to a community that does good in the world. GRU offers a wide array of activities with a group of really nice people. You can find a lot of the things the three authors are advocating in any month at GRU. Think about pub nights, book clubs, drumming, book studies, meditation, and choir, and I know I'm always missing about 10 more things, but to name just a few. And if you don't see what you want, just wait a bit. Somebody's likely to offer it. And if they don't, step up and start it yourself. I admit that an old career habit of mine, that of trying to find ways to be hyper-efficient, makes me want to form a weekly walking group that spends time in nature, is being grateful, being mindful, discussing good books, sharing stories, to get all the things into one activity. See me after service if you're interested. I'm only half kidding. I'm mostly kidding, but hey. We all love the music at GRU, but did you know listening to music and singing can reduce your cortisol or stress hormones? Singing as part of a community helps us release oxytocin, a feel-good hormone, and it increases our feeling of well-being and belonging. So go ahead and sing in the shower, sing in a choir, sing right here, and if you don't like to sing, listening to music can be a spiritual connecting experience as well. Donating time or money to the congregation gives us positive feelings and has psychological effects, benefits. Think about our A Better Tent City fundraising event as an example. It can give us a sense of purpose, doing good in the world. We are working together on a common goal. It increases our sense of belonging in the community. We feel we can make a difference and accomplish goals in life. There are many, many ways to volunteer your time at GRU, so look for ways to give of yourself as you can. Opportunities for social interaction is another benefit of attending GRU. I've already explained the dangers of isolation. In interacting with people, like chatting before service or during coffee hour, also stimulates the brain. Regular social interactions can lift mood, improve the immune system, and give you a generally better quality of life. As we age, we lose family and friends, and GRU is a place to reinforce old relationships or to make new friends. We all need to feel loved, acknowledged, and validated. Let's offer that to others and seek it ourselves within our community. Now, I want to address something. For the introverts out there, I know you've been wondering, this social interaction stuff, exactly how much time do I have to spend with people? I believe the research, Brenda, but how much? Tell me how much. Okay, you ready? Okay. The answer is 1 to 3 hours a day is ideal. Don't faint. That sounds like a lot, I know. But what that is, it includes every single interaction you have with a human being in a day. And scientists have found that, generally speaking, we get about 34 minutes a day with other people, which is obviously way too little. So tally up all the time that you spend with, for example, the drive-through guy at Tim Hortons, the person in a line up at the no-frills with you, a bank teller, your coworkers, neighbors, and even family and friends, and see what you get. And you don't have to turn into a social butterfly and make 25 new best friends. Again, if that was the answer, I wouldn't be up here. Researchers have found that having a friendly relationship with 3 to 5 people is enough to feel happier and healthier. And some of the tips they suggest are, look up old friends that you've lost contact with. And a really radical one, meet a Facebook friend in person. I know. Strike up conversations with your neighbor. Again, whoa. or coworkers. Try making a deeper connection with a casual acquaintance you already have. Join social, interest, or hobby groups to meet a broader circle of friends. Take a class to learn a new language, a new style of cooking, or learn about gardening. You will likely meet new interesting people. Many of them are probably looking for a friend too. After all, they joined the group. Something I found interesting is that generally speaking, as human beings, when it comes to making time for relationships, we overestimate the time required and we underestimate the benefits. But the research is clear. It is in your best interest to invest time and effort to cultivate warm social relationships, as they give back many times their cost and effort in increased happiness over your lifetime. But make sure they're healthy relationships. Let go of stressful relationships. We all benefit short-term and long-term from the release of oxytocin, dopamine, serotonin, and endorphins from positive relationships with others. So I hope I've given you some things to think about and some ideas about ways to live a good long life, a happy, healthy life. Whether you are in your first, second, or third act, we all need to think about how our lives will play out. As part of the GRU community, you only have to look at the TAB newsletter to find something that may help invest in your old age happiness account or to get you started in your journey to a happier, healthier life. Thank you. I have a special two visitors here today. Dad and Lillian, do you want to stand up? This is my dad, George, his fiancée, Lillian. They came to they came to see my debut.
How'd you do, George? That's good? Thumbs up? Two thumbs up. Stay seated, please, for our closing hymn. The words are in your order of service.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jay, Curtis, Keenan, and Brenda, for that lovely reflection. I'll close with a thought by Susan Moen. She says, "It annoys me when people say, even if you're old, you can be young at heart." Hiding inside this well-meaning phrase is a deep cultural assumption that old is bad and young is good. What's wrong with being old at heart, I'd like to know? Wouldn't you like to be loved by people whose hearts have practiced loving for a long time? Please rise, let us carry the flame. Let the people say, amen. If you're gaining